Let me show you why this is a bad design. After I created my contact sensor, I wanted to use the same design to create more sensors. The first two that came to mind were motion sensors and climate sensors. And in this video, I will focus on the climate sensor. Luckily, creating a climate sensor didn't require a lot of work, as it was very similar to the contact sensor. They are both wireless and they have a lot of components in common. And since the wake up mechanism was done in software, I just need to modify the code. In the contact sensor, I used an internal microswitch to wake it up, but in the climate sensor, I need to wake it up periodically to send the temperature readings. Again, luckily the ATtiny has a timer that I can use. And by doing a quick research into how often I should be sending the updates, I found that most temperature sensors do it every 15 minutes, so I will use that. Small issue though, the longest sleep period that the ATtiny can do is 8 seconds. To solve it, I counted roughly 120 sleep periods to get my 15-minute intervals. So that means every 120 wake-ups, the ATtiny powers up the ESP8266, just like the contact sensor. The ESP8266 then reads the climate data, sends it over ESP now, and goes back to sleep. And this repeats over and over again every 15 minutes. Well, not exactly 15 minutes, as the internal clock of the ATtiny is not very accurate, but it's good enough. And that was the basic idea behind this climate sensor, and it works surprisingly well without any modifications. For the actual temperature and humidity readings, I chose this. Which brings me to the first problem. This temperature and humidity sensor, the infamous DHT22. If you Google Arduino temperature projects, you will find this sensor hands down dominating the field. But in practice, specifically for battery operated devices, this is such a horrible sensor. And to narrow it down, I will highlight two major issues that I faced. First, reliability. It's not very reliable. In theory, they look like good sensors, easy to use with tons of libraries. They also have a very good temperature range, from minus 40 Celsius all the way to 80. The humidity is also very good. It covers the whole range from 0 to 100. It only requires one wire for its digital serial communication. What else can you ask for? Well, actually, a lot. Right out of the box, they need to be calibrated. Out of the 5 sensors I have, 3 needed major adjustments. On top of that, some didn't even make it past 2 years. So yes, from my experience, they are not very reliable and they don't last very long. And now today's video sponsor, PCBWay. I have been using PCBWay for years, and they are my go-to manufacturer for all my prototypes. I've been averaging a week from the time I place an order to the time I have them in my hands. I'm very happy with the quality so far, and ordering PCBs have come a long way, especially for hobbyists. So I encourage you to give them a visit. I will put a link to their site down below. Now back to the sensor. The second issue I had with these sensors was the cold boot period. This is the time the device needs to boot up, stabilize, and send its readings. To their credit though, it's right there in the datasheet and I 100% missed it. The sensor needs 2 full seconds before it is ready. This is very bad news for energy consumption, as the ESP8266 will have to sit idle waiting for the temperature sensor to get ready. To give you some perspective, the contact sensor is done in less than a fifth of a second. This includes waking up, reading the contact status, sending a message out, and going back to sleep. This sensor, however, will require almost 10 times that amount, wasting 10 times the energy. That is a full order of magnitude. I tried to see if I can minimize this 2 seconds, but the answer is no. Anything less than 2 seconds and I start getting garbage data. Again, not its fault. I don't think this sensor was ever meant for battery operated devices, at least efficiently. Luckily, while designing the PCB, I made a place for another sensor, this one, DS18B20+. I got lucky because I was able to test and compare both sensors side by side. I am happy to report that the two major issues I was facing are no longer a problem. It has been reliable so far, and by the time the ESP8266 is ready to read the temperature, it's already available. However, there is one small downside. If you have noticed, this temperature sensor doesn't provide humidity readings, only the temperatures. But that's a trade-off I'm willing to accept at this point. Now, let me turn to you. Do you have any hands-on experience with a good, reliable, efficient temperature and humidity sensor for me to try? If you do, please let me know down below. And if you too want to experiment with this design, I will make the PCB and maybe a kit available in my store. And that's it for me. I hope you learned something or two from this experiment. And thank you for watching.